The arrangement that existed between the triumvirs, Caesar, Pompeius, and Crassus, stated that none could act unilaterally. For any decision, the support of at least one other triumvir was needed. So, when Publius Clodius Pulcher came to the Pontifex Maximus requesting a dispensation to be adopted by a man younger than himself, we are told that Pompeius supported the adoption. However, it's possible that Pompeius did not know of Clodius's intent to run Cicero out of Rome. But Caesar may have, and, by the time Pompeius knew, it was too late. He was caught in a trap of Caesar's creation. During Clodius's 57 BC tribunate, accusations that his adoption was illegal brought into question the legitimacy of all his legislation. And with the heavy-handedness of his methods, talk of nullifying Clodius's entire slate of reforms was mentioned. Clodius responded by letting the Senate know that his legislation was passed in exactly the same manner as Caesar's legislation of the 59 BC year. If Clodius's legislation was to be overturned for such reasons, then certainly the Senate ought to rescind Caesar's legislation as well. In the event the Senate nullified all Caesar's laws, commented Clodius, then he would personally fetch Cicero back from exile on his own shoulders. While this may sound like erratic behavior on Clodius's part, fighting first for Caesar, then seeming to suddenly turn against him and Pompeius, it is also likely that, of Clodius's many responsibilities to Caesar, keeping Pompeius in check was chief among them. Pompeius had a long history of capitalizing on the wars of others, by seizing upon any little mishap for stripping generals of their commands, allowing him to rush in at the last moment to save the day. Caesar needed the war in Gaul to recover the deep financial losses he took running for offices he could not afford. But, neither could Caesar predict how easy or difficult his task would be. And so, Caesar unleashed Clodius to prevent Pompeius from capitalizing on the first thing that might go wrong in Caesar's Gallic campaign. Though Clodius was driven by personal vengeance, he also served Caesar's agenda by ousting Cicero, removing the one man who could persuade Pompeius to again side with the conservatives. Clodius's response to the Senate regarding the nullification of all Caesar's legislation was also a point-blank reminder to Pompeius that the ratifications of his eastern settlements, and the land carved out for his veterans, were all neatly tied up in Caesar's legislative agenda. Nullify Caesar's legislation, and all Pompeius's achievements disappeared too. What choice did Pompeius have but to support Caesar when all his victories were now tied to Caesar's success? Finally, Clodius's legislation to free Tigranus the Younger, and his subsequent blockade of Pompeius's home, undermined the authority and prestige of Pompeius Magnus. Rome's greatest general hid in his home, threatened by a tribune of the plebs. So, when Cicero's brother, Quintus, approached Pompeius to ask for his help in the recall of Cicero, Pompeius was forced to present the offer to Caesar. If they could manage Cicero's recall, Quintus promised the three triumvirs that Cicero would no longer publicly speak against or criticize them. But Caesar was not yet ready for Cicero to return. He still could not risk Pompeius sliding back to the side of the conservatives, nor had Caesar acquired sufficient military glory to meet Pompeius as an equal. Caesar did, however, affirm that he would support the recall of Cicero following Clodius's term as tribune of the plebs. In 57 BC, Rome's new consuls took office. Caesar's father-in-law, Piso Caesarninus, the 58 BC consul, stepped down from office, and was given the province of Macedonia to govern. Pompeius's man, Aulus Gabinius, stepped down, and into the office of proconsul of Syria. The new consuls were Cornelius Lentulus Spinther, and Metellus Nepos. Spinther enjoyed the support of both Caesar and Pompeius. Metellus Nepos, however, was exclusively Pompeius's man. Following the Catilina conspiracy, Nepos, as tribune of the plebs, had fought against Cato for the recall of Pompeius Magnus from the east, leading to a physical assault which prevented Nepos from speaking to the plebeian assembly. When Pompeius married Caesar's daughter, however, Nepos was among those supporters who began pulling away. But Pompeius could not afford to lose allies, and threw his support behind Nepos for the consulship. Unfortunately, the new consuls stepped into a Rome that was falling apart at the seams. After a year feeding the bellies of Rome's poor, without monetary compensation, Rome's granaries were starting to run low. Cicero, the voice of stability, was exiled. Cato, the unofficial leader of the Boni, was out of Rome. The collegium gangs of Publius Clodius terrorized the city, and Caesar was in Gaul. In January, with the new consuls taking office, as well as the new tribunes of the plebs, a formal motion was put before the Senate for the recall of Marcus Tullius Cicero. Although few had stepped forward to defend Cicero against the possibility of their own exile, Cicero still remained popular within the Senate. The bill to recall Cicero was supported by both of the consuls, Spinther and Nepos, as well as several new tribunes of the plebs, including Titus Annius Milo and Publius Cestius. When Pompeius spoke in favor of Cicero's recall, the rest of the Senate felt emboldened enough to support the bill. Although Clodius, who was no longer a tribune of the plebs, voted against the recall of Cicero, the motion passed within the Senate. 24 days later, when the bill was taken to the plebeian assembly for a vote, Publius Clodius arrived with a large retinue of armed gladiators standing alongside his collegium gangs. A wall of swords, clubs, and daggers moved against the public assembly. Screaming voters ran in all directions. Those who could not escape were cut down in the Forum Romanum. Tribunes of the plebs, whose persons were sacrosanct according to Roman law, were seriously injured. By the time Clodius had finished, the Forum Romanum was littered with bodies and stained with blood. Titus Annius Milo, a tribune of the plebs who emerged from the bloodbath with only minor injuries, proposed fighting fire with fire. Getting the approval of Pompeius, Milo and another tribune, Gaius Cestius, began enlisting and arming gladiators of their own. If Rome was now to be governed by gangs of the streets, then the Senate needed its own horse in the race. Violence broke out all over the city. Everywhere Clodius and his gangs went, Milo and his gang were there. Throughout the city, dead bodies lay in the streets, the Forum Romanum was awash in blood, and corpses floated along the Tiber River. Rome descended into utter anarchy. More than ever, the public cried out for the return of Cicero. To the common people, he was no longer the man who had executed Roman citizens without a trial but, once again, he was the man who single-handedly saved Rome from Catilina's conspiracy. People, terrified to leave their homes, longed for Cicero's stabilizing hand to steer Rome back toward some semblance of normalcy. During the spring of the 57 BC year, Pompeius undertook a propaganda tour of Italy. In various provinces, the great Pompeius Magnus, whose celebrity drew huge crowds, reminded the locals that Cicero, from Arpinum, was one of them, a fellow Italian countryman. They extolled Cicero's work ethic, and told of the great love and support Sicily's farmers gave to him. By enthusiastically supporting Cicero, Pompeius encouraged the local Italians to flood into the city in support of Cicero's recall. In the Senate, Lucius Licinius Lucullus introduced legislation to formally lift Cicero's banishment. With the city packed full of his supporters, and the common people crying out for the return of Cicero, the Senate, again, ratified the legislation. 24 days later, when it was time for the plebeian assembly to vote, Clodius, again, arrived with his gang of thugs and gladiators. This time, however, Clodius saw that Milo and his gang were fully prepared to defend the people. Clodius turned and left. The vote passed the plebeian assembly with flying colors. 16 months after fleeing Rome, the exile of Marcus Tullius Cicero was lifted. He was on his way home.